Very good morning, all of you. We are here for the first webinar series of shoulder rehabilitation and lecture number 3. So I'm Dr. Ravindran. I'm the host for this evening. So I'm happy to welcome you all on behalf of Mumbai branch of Indian Association of Physiotherapists and Arthroscopy Academy, Mumbai. So for a trouble-free viewing, I request all the participants to keep the microphones in mute till the lectures are over. And type your question answers in the chat box so that we can take it over to the speakers. And keep your videos off to save some amount of bandwidth so that we can have uninterrupted viewing. So for further, I will ask Dr. Ajita, who is our moderator for today. She's a senior physiotherapist working with Tata Memorial Hospital and a EC member of Indian Association of Physiotherapy, Mumbai branch. So for further proceedings, let me ask Dr. Ajita to carry forward.
Thank you, Dr. Ravindran. Good evening, everyone. On behalf of Mumbai branch of Indian Association of Physiotherapists in collaboration with Arthroscopy Academy, Mumbai, I, Dr. Ajita, welcome all to this webinar series on shoulder rehabilitation. Today is the third session and the topic is rotator cuff injuries, and physiotherapy management. The chairperson for this session is Dr. Jyotsna Tosar, assistant professor from Physiotherapy School and Centers, St. G.S. Medical College and K.M. Hospital. She has done her post-graduation in musculoskeletal physiotherapy, currently pursuing PhD in physiotherapy at St. G.S. Medical College. She has been teaching undergraduates since 18 years and postgraduates since 13 years. She is member of BOS at Physiotherapy in Padma Shri D.Y. Patil University, member of UNESCO, GSMC, MUHS Bioethics Unit, and member of Physiotherapy Department Review Board, St. G.S. Medical College. Kindly welcome Dr. Jyotsna Tosar as chairperson. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Ajita, for the warm introduction. One and all, very good afternoon to one and all. Today we are having the third session of the series where we are dealing with the shoulder pathologies, and today's speaker, we have got two speakers today, Dr. Abhishek Nerurkar and Dr. Ajit Dabholkar. So first I will introduce Dr. Abhishek Nerurkar. Dr. Abhishek has done his MS and DNB in orthopedics from Sancheti Hospital. The field of sports medicine and arthroscopy always fascinated him, and he decided to pursue and learn more about it. He has done his fellowship in sports medicine from Stuttgart, Germany, Sport Clinic and Katharinen Hospital. He has also done fellowship in advanced hip and knee joint replacement from International Society of Orthopedic Surgery and Traumatology. He has served as an assistant professor in the Department of Science and HBTMC Ville-Parle. As a part of his love for research and teaching, he has participated in various academic activities and teaching programs, and he has also published 4 papers in the Index Journal as a primary author. Currently, he is attached as a consultant to various reputed hospitals in Mumbai, namely Hinduja Healthcare, SL Raheja Fortis, Holy Spirit Hospital. So now I request Dr. Abhishek Nerurkar to start with his presentation.
Thank you very much for inviting me. I thank Indian Association of Physiotherapists and Arthroscopy Academy to inviting me. I suppose I'm audible clearly.
Yes, sir. You are.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So just shared my screen. Okay. So, just a short introduction. As Dr. Ajita said, the first interaction with arthroscopy was in Sancheti, and there I decided that I'm going to take this up very seriously. So I decided to go to Stuttgart and learn from the masters. After I was back, I served as assistant professor in Sion Hospital and Ishwari Trauma Center. I was there as a head of unit for around 5 years. So that was a foundation. So you have to basically understand that most of the times when we talk about rotator cuff, it is taken into consideration that we are talking about supraspinatus. Okay, so anatomy is very important. You have to know that there are four rotator cuff muscles, and each of them has equal roles. Now, why is it important? It is because they form force couples to keep the head centralized. Okay, so when you are treating a shoulder pathology or a cuff pathology, most often a degenerative pathology, you have to take into consideration all these four, examine them individually, and then come to a diagnosis. Okay, so I'm going to touch up upon certain important clinical aspects of anatomy. I'm not going to talk about the origin, insertion, and everything. So why is the insertion point important? If you see the supraspinatus, which is the major rotator cuff muscle, the insertion of supraspinatus is much smaller than the insertion of the infraspinatus. Both these tendons are inserted in a J-shaped manner. If you see, supraspinatus and infraspinatus overlap with each other, and even most of the times when we look arthroscopically, the supraspinatus tendon will be bilamellated. So there are two lamellas of supraspinatus, one upon each other. And this is very important because you have to restore the whole muscle tendon unit and put it back onto your footprint. So infraspinatus, if you look at the shoulder from the back, the infraspinatus and the teres minor muscle have strong capsular insertion. So if you see on the top, there is infraspinatus muscle. On the bottom, there is a teres minor muscle. And in between both, the white structure that you see where the star is marked is the strong capsule. And both these muscles also have the insertion of the capsule, and capsule in turn goes and inserts into the greater tubercle. Okay, so they form the cable on the posterior aspect. I'll come to the cable concept in a short time. And when there is anterior and a posterior cable, they basically balance each other and then centralize the shoulder. So what are the surgical implications? If you see the left side, the tears in the shoulder, in the rotator cuff are always named as per the patterns. So you may see a tear which is a U-shaped tear, which is on the left side. You may see a tear which in the center is a L-shaped tear. Now, if you understand the tear patterns which you look intraoperatively are so unless you actually reduce that particular tear to its footprint, it is very difficult to understand how this rotator cuff is going to be treated. So whenever we basically go intra-articularly and see the tendon of the rotator cuff, we have to completely mobilize it, and then we get it back to the position, and then we reassess the tear pattern and decide how we are going to fix the rotator cuff tendon. Subscapularis is often the most neglected muscle in evaluation. Most of the time it is missed even in radiological findings. So the radiologist may not report subscap. And then there are a lot of issues that happen because if during the restoration of the anatomy, if the supraspinatus of the subscapularis is left in alone, then there is going to be a lot of issues in the rehab part also and the result part also. So it is the strong internal rotator of the shoulder, and it inserts on the LT. Okay, so this is the anterior portion of the shoulder. Okay, this is a biceps tendon, which is a lighthouse. On the middle aspect of the biceps, you'll find the the subscapularis muscle. When you remove the biceps, you'll see that there's a large attachment of the subscapularis muscle on the lesser tuberosity. If you look at the widest points, it is almost 4 cm by 1 cm. So it is a very huge attachment that is there as compared to the supraspinatus and infraspinatus. And how is it clinically important? It is because most of the times when we started treating subscapularis, it was fixed with a single anchor, and there were a lot of failures that were happening. That is because at single point of insertion, we will not be able to restore the anatomy. And so now then we started putting in more anchors so that we get a stable flat fixation on the LT, and the outcomes have certainly improved after it has been done. There's one more thing that we have to understand, that there are sometimes the tears are very large, and when we operate, we cannot get these tears 100% back under the tuberosity, because a lot of the times they are chronic and the tears are retracted, the tendon is retracted. If we try to pull it too much, we can cause more harm rather than giving benefit. And then you have to take a decision whether this particular tear can be sutured back to its normal position, or can we suture it back to somewhere else, or we have to do with the alternate plans, like with that later. So that is decided by the cable concept. If you see, the supraspinatus forms the anterior cable. Okay, anterior cable, supraspinatus. The infraspinatus and teres minor, along with its capsular insertion, they do form the posterior cable. And if you can get these two particular cables in their position, then it is possible that you may get away by doing a rotator cuff repair, and the top portion, which has not been able to reduce, can be medialized. Medialized in the sense, if the insertion of the tendon is at the point of my arrow, we can certainly take it almost 0.8 to 1 centimeter medially and fix it there, which will give good options, good outcome to the patient. Okay, so why is anatomy important? It is because, as you know, that scapula is the foundation of the shoulder girdle, and you have to look at the shoulder joint as a whole. You have to look at the AC joint, you have to look at the acromion, clavicle, the tendons around. So multiple joints and tendons are working in tandem to apply or generate force couples. And rotator cuff tears are most often in a degenerative pathology, unless it is a trauma. And there are multiple pathologies coexistent along with the rotator cuff tear. So if you diagnose a patient with a supraspinatus and just neglect everything else, then you are going to be in a problem, because you are going to give suboptimal results to the patients. So it is very easy to miss out on the smaller contributors when you are, you know, looking at the bigger ones. And that particular blinds us out and leads us to suboptimal output. So do not take or do not jump on conclusions early. You have to evaluate the patient thoroughly. You have to evaluate, re-evaluate, look again for what you're missing, and then you come to a reasonable diagnosis and take the treatment forward. Okay, so again, shoulder is, if two different people examine shoulder, it's possible that they might come to a different diagnosis, or they may have a different mindset of how to treat a particular patient, because shoulder pathologies depend on numerous variables. Always take into consideration all the factors: history, examination, special tests that we are going to come to, and investigations. Okay, and then you come to a diagnosis. However, whatever you do and whatever you measures you take, a lot of the times we have already seen that when you enter the joint with the arthroscope, you definitely find something new inside. So these particular things can be sometimes misleading. So whenever we do take up arthroscopy sessions, or we are teaching the beginners, we always tell them to do a arthroscopic diagnostic round. Because a lot of the times, if you don't do a diagnostic round, and if you enter into a surgery with a preconceived mind, then there is high likelihood that you are going to miss something which is not evident previously. Okay, so diagnostic round is extremely important, and it is possible that you might find something different on the investigations and different on the arthroscopic findings. So you have to prepare for the for everything that you can come across the horizon. So if you look at the cuff pathology, it can be broadly classified into two main types, and the trauma and degenerative, and both these types are going to be different in terms of the planning and different in terms of outcomes. So if you see a traumatic tear, which usually occurs in young or middle-aged people, it is the cuff is usually good. the muscle is also usually good, and then you can actually restore it quite near to the normal as compared to the degenerative part. So if you have a degenerative cuff tear, it is usually associated with multiple other comorbidities or pathologies, and that can actually significantly alter your outcome in terms of fixation also, and in terms of rehabilitation also. So as I said, traumatic tears usually occur in relatively young patients and middle-aged patients, and they have good outcomes when you can fix it back to them as early as possible. Muscle tendons are good, can be associated with dislocations, or can be associated with subtle subluxations. So you have to make sure that you don't find any labral pathology along with it, or any slap lesions or something. So when it dislocates with subtle, there is going to be some kind of a capsular or labral or capsular kind of injury. So you have to look for that. Retraction is very less in these patients, and you can get them back, get the tendons back to their insertion pretty well. You have to be very wary of bony bruises, because you're going to fix it with the anchors. And if there is a bony edema and the bone is already inflamed, then these anchors might pull off, or you may not get the kind of fixation that you expect. Elderly patient, look for comorbidities. Most of the time you'll see diabetes, hypothyroidism, multiple comorbidities, and multiple coexisting pathologies also. Pain is very uncommon in isolated supraspinatus tear. And whenever there is pain, you have to look for other pathologies. Okay. Sometimes you might get a pain because of the deltoid fatigue. And the other things that you have to look for is AC joint, biceps, and everything around. Okay, so pain usually occurs late in the disease, and pain is a very common symptom in case of arthropathy, in which night sleep is affected. Again, range of motions are the way we check. Range of motion is different from the how we check in the other joints. We are mainly interested in the forward elevation. Abduction is the movement that is done in the coronal plane, and forward elevation is the movement in ital plane. External rotation, both in adduction and in 90 degrees of abduction, is important and can be defining, and it can change depending on the pathologies. And the last is internal rotation, which we see with the amount of the level of the spine that we can touch. Okay, so both active and passive range are important, because if you have a capsular pathology, you're going to have a problem in the passive range, which has to be corrected before you go for the active range. Weakness or any tears are going to cause a loss in the active range of motion. So if there's a wasting, you have to also consider that there can be neuromuscular causes like brachial neuritis, supraspinatus neuropathy, or radiculopathy. And if there is a weakness, it can be calcific tendinitis, fractures, spinal glenoid cyst, supraspinatus tendinosus. So neuromuscular pathologies, cyst in the spinal glenoid, supraglenoid notch, suprascapular nerve involvement, all these things can also lead to supraspinatus and infraspinatus weakness. And you should also consider them before you come to any diagnosis. Okay, so I'll just brush through the tests. Most common tests that I do, because there is a plethora of tests that you can do for shoulders. But the full can and the empty can test, that is for the supraspinatus. For the infraspinatus, we look for for the external rotation. And it's very important to keep the arm in adduction before you do the external rotation, because at this particular point, the muscle is at the proper stretch to give you maximum results. And you can also look for the external rotation lat test. Subscapularis is a muscle which is difficult to, as you can see the wasting in the supraspinatus and infraspinatus fossas. If you have a weak muscle, it is very difficult to see that particular, elicit that in inspection in case of subscapularis. You have a Gerbert lift-off test, Bearhug test, belly press test. Again, we are testing for internal rotation. And if there's an internal rotation in weakness, then you can basically elicit. Teres minor, you have to look at the drop arm sign and the horn blowers test. The drop arm sign is when you are doing abduction and external rotation, you just leave it there. And if the patient is not able to maintain external rotation, and the horn blower test is actively testing for external rotation in abduction. Now, teres minor is the smallest rotator cuff muscle, and the involvement is much lesser as compared to the other muscles. Most of the time, the tests will be revealed positive only in cases of massive tests. So, if these tests are positive, you should consider that there will be supraspinatus as well as infraspinatus tear, because unless these are there, the tests are usually not positive. So, in a rotator cuff, in a degenerative case, always check for impingement. You have to do, there are two tests, Nies test and Hawkins Kennedy test, whichever you do. I usually do a Hawkins Kennedy test, and impingement is very important, because if you are having a less of a subacromial space, then results are going to change. So you have to correct that particular fact also. Always test for the biceps. Okay, so groove tests, speed test, and ergastin test. I usually do the ergastin test, in which you externally rotate. You try to externally rotate, and you tell the patient to internally rotate the arm in 90 degrees of the flexion of the elbow with the arm adapted. And if there's pain or there's inability to do it, then the test is considered to be positive. So one more thing that will come across in most of the rotator cuff patients is adhesive capsulitis. So in general, the shoulder surgeons, the consensus is that adhesive capsulitis is a condition of when the etiology is unknown, and it is characterized by significant restriction of both active and passive range of motion of the shoulder joint. It occurs in absence of known intrinsic shoulder disorder. Okay, so sequence of loss of movement is usually the first movement that is lost is restriction of the external rotation. This happens due to overriding. So if you see, there are two external rotators, that is your infraspinatus and the teres minor, and there are a lot of internal rotators. So if you see, subscap is a very strong muscle, latissimus dorsi, major, teres major, all these things are causing internal rotation. And whenever there is kind of the pathology, the internal rotation precedes over the external rotation, and then you develop a lack of external rotation. Okay, once the disease progresses, the internal rotation, this internal rotation contracture develops because of the irritation of the biceps. So now the external rotation is also gone, and the internal rotation is also affected. And then you have the loss of abduction, because to abduct to a certain degree is going to require external rotation. Unless you have the external rotation, you will not be able to clear the acromion. The head is not able to clear the acromion, and this is going to cause loss of abduction. So many times you'll get patients, and the coexistent pathologies are so confusing. You may not understand whether there's a cervical radiculopathy, it's spondylosis, trapeziitis, some may term as fibromyalgia, ACL arthritis. So all these things are going to be coexistent, and you have to differentiate the upper limb radiating pain, the girdle pain, and multiple coexisting pathologies to come to a diagnosis. Also, sometimes the rotator cuff weakness may exhibit as with the symptoms of tennis elbow and decurvians tenosynovitis because of the kinetic chain principle. If there's excruciating pain, most of the time it will be either arthropathy or it can be calcific tendinitis. And sometimes you have to be very careful, because a Pancoast tumor, that is a tumor at the apex of the lung, can also mimic a very bad shoulder pain and night pains, and you may actually miss it if you are not aware of what can happen. Primary investigations, again, we start with x-rays. Most of the conditions with cuff tear, the x-rays will be normal. But if there's calcific tendinitis, if there is arthropathy, if there's glenohumeral arthritis, all these things are going to be evident in cases if there's a superior migration of the head, and you have to understand that this is a chronic thing and the treatment is going to be difficult. The second test that is done is ultrasound. Again, the advantages are just dynamic, you can do provocative measures, but it cannot evaluate the complex tear patterns, and it is less reliable in diagnosis of other intra-articular pathologies. Okay, so if you see this ultrasound, you often see that there is a hypoechoicity at the level of the tear, and then you can, so there you need a good radiologist to do an ultrasound, and you are dependent on the on the findings that a person gives. Whereas the other test that you do, MRI, it is what I usually do is I don't do an ultrasound unless I want to do a ultrasound guided injection or something like that. Most of the time, it is going to be an MRI, excellent evaluation of intra-articular conditions, tendon muscle quality evaluation is very good, and demonstration of cuff tear and retraction. So you can see everything pretty well on the MRI most of the time. Just in short, what you need to see, because unless you actually see it and you know what to see, it is very difficult to just read the report and decide what you're going to do. So I usually see my own MRIs. I don't depend on the radiologist evaluation of the MRIs. So if you see on the first image, it's a coronal section, and this is the rotator cuff. You can see it is a very smooth structure, goes and inserts into the greater trochanter, greater tuberosity. Whereas in the second image, you will see that lot of edema there. The acromion is coming down and impinging into the spinatus tendon. The tendon is bent, the space is limited, and at the insertion, this is a T2 weighted image, so at the insertion you'll see the white signal which signifies full thickness tear. If you see the sagittal images, the supraspinatus looks like a very bulky muscle in between the clavicle, the coracoid and the acromion. Whereas a atrophied muscle will look as a very shrunken measure. It's called the tangent sign. So if you draw a line from coracoid to the acromion, the supraspinatus should be over that particular line. So if it is under that, it means it's a chronic tear and there is a fatty degeneration, and you have to be very careful about these tears. Subscapularis, again, if you see a T1 weighted image, which is on the left side, the tendon will look like a black structure and comes and inserts into the LT. In a T2 image, T2 weighted image, you see the pathology and the tendon is coming till the arrow and it stops there. So the white signal is the tear. So there's a fluid accumulation. So this is a complete subscapularis tear. What else you need to know? You need to know the anatomy of the acromion, because that is going to change your treatment plan. The BNE has classified this acromion into three types. One is the straight one. The type two is a curved acromion, which is present in a lot of cases with the rotator cuff tear. And the type three is a hooked acromion. So if you have a hooked acromion, then definitely you will have to go and excise that particular hook. Otherwise, if you reduce the tear, fix it, and if you don't treat the acromion, it is very likely that this tear is going to reappear. Okay, it's going to re-tear because there's irritation there. Other thing is acromio-humeral distance. Normal acromio-humeral distance is 8 mm to 10 mm. If there's any reduction of this distance, then you have to clear the space for the normal gliding of the tendon. You should also realize that these acromio-humeral distance changes with the version of the glenoid. So if your scapula is not in place, you have to actually stabilize the scapula first, because unless you get the scapula to the position, you cannot get a free space for your tendon to be mobilized. One more concept that was there in deciding whether you should do an acromioplasty, so whether you take a acral surgery or not, was a critical shoulder angle. This was the angle that was, so there was line joint at the superior and inferior part of the glenoid and lateral aspect of the acromion. It was converted and it converges at the inferior aspect of the glenoid, and any angle, so normal angle is between 30 to 35 degrees. If it is lesser than that or greater than that, then you may have to do acromioplasty and convert that critical shoulder angle between 30 and 35 degrees. Okay, so if it is less than 30, then the chances of arthritis are very more increased, and if it is more than 35, then the chances of rotator cuff increase. Another decision making factor in deciding whether you'll be going ahead with the fixation of the rotator cuff, that is a repair, or you have to do additional techniques like for the irreparable rotator cuff, depends on the fatty infiltration. So Guttilleri had given a classification in 1994, so that he basically evaluates the fat. He did it with the CT scan, but now we do it with the MRI scan. So a normal muscle, that is a type 1 muscle, will not have any fatty streaks. Type 2 will have multiple, type 2 will have some fatty streaks. Okay, 1 and 2 muscles types are very easily reducible and they don't have that much of tension. Type 3 will have fatty infiltration present, but there is more muscle than fat in type 3, and even type 3 can be reduced with some amount of difficulty. But once you go to type 4 and type 5, where there is more fat as compared to the muscle, then the situations get tricky, because you may not be able to get them. Even if you get them back to the position, they may not be able to get the strength that is desired for the function, maintain the head glenoid. And that is where the other techniques come into picture. Most often, when you have a rotator cuff tear, a degenerative one, the biceps is going to be involved. So you look for the biceps in the bicipital groove, whether it is centered, sublux, dislocated, ruptured. So these four things you're going to see. And if you have a bicipital pathology, then you should always look for, if there's a, especially if there's a subluxation or a dislocation, you should always look for a subscapular pathology also, because isolated biceps pathologies is again very rare. You know, you can get a patient with isolated bicipital tendinosis, but there is something wrong happening internal that is basically causing that biceps to get to degenerate. So once you come to a diagnosis, then how do you plan management? Most of the time, unless there is a severe tear with restriction, retraction, we always give a conservative trial before you go to operative, unless there is a frank tear which is with a pseudo paralysis. So you know that this particular patient is not going to benefit much from the physiotherapy. Okay. And there are intervening techniques, like there are muscle injections, manipulation under general anesthesia. All these techniques are there. We'll come to that. All of them are controversial. So a lot of times patients your patients will ask, there's a tear, do I need to undergo surgery? The simple answer is that not all cuff patients will require surgery. There is a paper by Yamamoto. They had taken asymptomatic population. It's from Japan and published in Journal of Shoulder and Elbow Surgery. They examined 683 people, 1,366 shoulders, and they found out that 20.7% of the patient did not exhibit any symptoms after a rotator cuff tear. This was a mean age of 57.9, so elderly people. So not all patients are going to require surgery. However, those patients who don't improve with the rehab will definitely require. Okay. So what is the main aim of the conservative management? There are two aims. One is to get the range of the movement back, and the second aim is to proceed with the strengthening of the muscles. So be extremely cautious when you plan for conservative, because I would like to say this particular statement, because if a lot of times patients do come and tell that there's a tear, I have been treated by a therapist for this much time and there has been no improvement, or they come and ask whether these particular therapies have caused this tear. So there are a lot of confusions that go across. So you be very cautious about what you are doing. When you plan for conservative, stress on getting the diagnosis completely. You formulate a diagnosis, explain the plan to the patient, tell them what are the possibilities that can happen, see whether the patient is confident about going ahead with this particular plan of management, and then go ahead. Because otherwise, they will have a lot of misconceptions about what has happened. So whether you can mobilize in pre-existing pain, pain is multifactorial source of the pain. So try to find out the source of the pain. Most of the time, if you start the rehab, if the head is not centered into the scapula, and if you can get it back into the scapula, into the glenoid, then the pain will reduce. There can be pain due to deltoid fatigue also, because of the supraspinatus weakening. You can start, if you understand the pathology, you can actually mobilize the patient in existence of pain also. If he's not improving, then we may go to local injections. And local injections are just given to alleviate the pain for time being, so that you can take over and give rehab. And if all these things are not working, then you'll have to put your thinking plan and evaluate further and come to a reasonable diagnosis. Okay, rotator cuff muscles are not very forgiving and it is very difficult to get them back because the head has to be centralized into the glenoid for the tendons or the muscle tendon units to be in optimum stretch. And if you can't do that, then whatever efforts are going into the therapy may not yield any great outcome. So you have to do first step first. First, you have to centralize the head. Second, you have to correct the passive ranges. And third, you have to get back to the strengthening. Okay. So again, I would rather give a time frame of 2 weeks to decide whether we are going on the right track or not. Perpetual treatment is not going to be of any help. So if at all we are not able to progress in a period of 2 to 3 weeks, then we have to reassess. We have to go back to the board and we have to find out what is wrong and what can be changed. So intra-articular injections role is very controversial. Nowadays, trying to avoid intra-articular injections wherever possible. Where to give intra-articular injections again depend on where the pathology is. If the pathology is inside the joint, then like adhesive capsulitis, then we work on the principle of linohumeral dilatation where we push in the saline, dilate the joint and hope for the best. If the pathology is extra-articular, if there is a supraspinatus tendinitis, if you think there's a bicipital pathology, so all these things are usually dealt with subacromial injection. Manipulation under general anesthesia was, I think, 10-15 years back. This was a very common procedure, but it is a very controversial procedure. A lot of research has been done, and we really don't know whether this works or not. It's a very uncontrolled procedure. You can have multiple problems like dislocations. You can have fractures, which is very, very difficult to explain to the patient what has happened. And sometimes you may get a range back. If the patient is not able to maintain it, you may get stiffness, which is actually very difficult to treat. So this is a very controversial topic. Nowadays, resorting not to do any manipulation. If there's any stiffness which is not resolving, then we do formal arthroscopic capsular release. So what to consider when you're changing the plan or planning operative management? Again, evaluation of the pathology. To stress on it because a lot of times the patient is taken on the table and then you realize that whatever we are thought of, it can happen. So we have to analyze the patient thoroughly, anticipation of problems, and discussion about the prognosis with the patient is very important. As you know that the patient has understood what is going to happen, then only you can go ahead with the operative plan. So, rotator cuff repair, acute tear, it is straightforward. Muscle tendon health is good and you can put it back. Chronic tear, again, you have to then put your thinking cap on and whether this tear is repairable or not. If it is not repairable, then what are the options that I'm going to have in front of me? Okay. What affects the prognosis or what affects the repair is size and geometry of the tear. Okay. So, what type the tear is, how we can reduce the tear, whether it comes to its normal position or not, what is the retraction of the tendon, how is the muscle quality, what is the quality of bone. So if the bone is really osteoporotic and if you fix the tendon with lot of force into the bone, the suture anchors might come out. So you have to assess the quality of the bone, and very important to see the healing potential of the cuff tissue and what you can do for better healing, and look for secondary changes or arthritis. As you can see on this x-ray, it's like an acetabulization of the glenoid. So in this case, if you try to do a rotator cuff repair, it's a day one failure. So question whether to do arthroscopic open repair. So there are certain advantages of arthroscopic rotator cuff repair. First of all, it's a closed procedure. So the soft tissue breaching or the soft tissue handling is very less. There's better delineation of the tear patterns because there's magnification. You can see everything on the screen with a lot of magnification. So you can very well So it there's a lot of learning curve. So a lot of people will say, no, I can do it better open. But once you cross that particular learning curve, then because of the magnification and the clarity, the tear pattern, mobilization, everything can be done much, much better with the arthroscopic surgery. So you can do mobilization first to see very well the release of the cuff to get it back to its position. All the other intra-articular structures can be treated simultaneously and faster able to function. There are certain things which are not there in our control. That is the cuff tissue quality, muscle quality, bone quality, and retraction reliability. So nowadays, even when you do a mini open or open, it has the capturing devices. The device that you see in the structure is a self-retrieving device. So these particular devices have made it really easy to get the bites at the appropriate positions into the tear. And you can do it much better. It was really difficult to do it without this these instruments because the acromion covers the tear of the subscapularis, and it is very difficult to visualize otherwise. So a lot of times you'll come across these terminologies, and the surgeon may say, I have done a single row repair or double row repair or transosseous repair. So what is it basically? So when we started around 10, 15 years, 20 years back, what was done was very simple. You put in the anchor. The red arrow that you see is how you put anchor inside the joint where the tendon is to be fixed. And then you pass the sutures to the cuff. Okay. And then there are various methods in which you can tie them. Okay. So once you tie the sutures, the cuff comes back and sits to this position. However, you have to understand. So as we saw the first few slides, the rotator cuff is attached over a large area and it is not attached over a single point. And that is why if you do this particular surgery, which has been done for years, you may not get that kind of a healing of the rotator cuff as you want it to happen. Okay. And then we started analyzing what is going wrong. And then you came to something that is known as the double row repair. In a double row repair, what you do basically is do the first row repair and then you take all these stitches and put it back on the lateral side of the GT. Okay, so now if you see this image, operative arthroscopic picture, you can see the knots which are tied here. This is the medial row, and all these threads or tapes which are taken into the lateral aspect and fixed into the lateral row. So this is a double row repair. The advantage is you get much more better fixation and restoration on the footprint. So you get a big area for the tendon to heal to the bone. In case there were few problems with the double row because there were a lot of stress coming on the medial side and loosening of the anchors. And in recent times, we have started doing hybrid fixations. So you are doing a triple row anchor. So triple loaded anchors which will have six threads coming out of a single anchor. So there are three sliding threads. So we may tie the two threads here, or we may tie one thread here, and we may not tie the rest of the threads. The rest of the threads are just taken and punched into a lateral row anchor so that there is no pull out. So these are the hybrid techniques which are, but this is a evolution of the double row repair. So basically, the surgeon will decide what is the best fixation modality, which is done after the assessment of the tear pattern and how the tear is reducing onto the footprint. Okay, so multiple ways of fixing single double row suture bridge split bridge. So what is a suture bridge? Is that you create a bridge between four points, and if you do the same bridge with the help of tape. So tapes are basically flat structures. The sutures are narrow and tapes are flat. So with the flat tapes, you can get better approximation, and the tearing of the tendons is also very less. So nowadays we are started preferring fixing it with the suture tapes rather than with the sutures. Okay, so this is a double row speed bridge. It's called as a speed bridge when you do it with a fiber tape. Okay, and what is improved? We have improved over the fixation modalities. So the anchors have improved. You get tapes, you get suture anchor where there is no device going inside. You get biocomposite anchors. you get anchors in which there are no knots. So these are the knotless anchors. Multiple things have come, and there is a plethora of devices that you can use, whatever is best for your patient. So again, it's a degenerative pathology. So a tendon sometimes may not be very healthy. And what you do for it is you do something like a microfracture that you do inside the knee joint. It's a Crimson Duvet microfracture. You make certain holes, some holes into the greater GT, and the blood that flows out from these holes will help in healing. So restoration of the biology is very important for healing. Biglianis classification, we have seen what is the clinical implication. If there is a rotator cuff that is getting impinged, if you have a curved acromion or a hooked acromion, then you have to do acromioplasty or subacromial decompression also. So this is the hook kind of a structure that is in the center portion, which has to be removed, because unless you remove that, patient may get re-tear or there will be a pain. So it will not give you that kind of optimal output. So do we need to tackle the biceps? Absolutely, yes. Most of the time, biceps will be involved, and you have to treat the biceps in elderly patients. There's one paper from Journal of Shoulder and Elbow Surgery which says that even if you don't have a very bad looking biceps in arthroscopically, all these patients do get bicipital problems later on, especially if they are elderly, because the biceps swells up after a certain time. So it is always better to treat these biceps in elderly patients. In young patients, you can just forget the biceps because you have to restore the anatomy. But in elderly patients, you have to do something for the biceps. Whether it is sternotomy or tenodesis, it's going to depend on how the biceps looks. If you see the D portion, the biceps is completely frayed and gone. It's better to remove all these biceps and then keeping them and trying to fix this. Okay, so I'll just skip this tenodesis part. Okay, so yeah, okay. So let us go back. So if you see, this is the intra-articular picture of the biceps, and what we used to do is fix these biceps inside the joint under the humeral head. But there were a lot of problems with this, because if you see the intervening portions into the bicipital groove, so many times the tendon in the bicipital groove is also affected. And that is why even after doing a tenodesis, it may not help. So now we are doing subpectoral tenodesis. That is, the tenodesis is done below the pec major. And so you expose it under the axilla. And there are various papers which show that this technique is really superior, and possibly have found a way out for this particular thing. Any other options when the cuff is not repairable? Okay, so if the cuff, you're not able to close the defect, if the tissue quality is poor, if there's a retraction and it is fixed, it is not coming, if the head is superiorly migrated, or there is subluxation, there are multiple techniques which are there. Nowadays, if the biceps is intact, and the partially you can get back the rotator cuff to its position, then we do something. This is known as the biceps bridge or rerouting. You fix the biceps there as if you do the tenodesis without cutting the biceps, and then suture the biceps to the rotator cuff. This is called as biceps bridge. Advantages: it can be done arthroscopically, less time, surgical time, less infection rate. However, you have to understand that the biceps has to be intact for that to do that. If you see this particular image on the right, the cuff is completely retracted. There is no way you can get this cuff back to the GT, and 100% this patient will have superior migration. So what do you do in these cases? You need to graft it. So you have to prevent the superior migration. Initially, it was started with the facial lata graft, but now there are dermal matrix, allografts, a lot of grafts. So you harvest the facial lata, make a 8 to 10 mm thick graft out of it, and then fix it between the glenoid and the GT. So that forms a buffer so that the head does not go and migrate superiorly, and it prevents some rotator cuff arthropathy. This can also be done with the dermal allografts. Okay, as in this, you can see that the technique is you put two anchors onto the glenoid, then you put two anchors on the GT, where you have to fix them. So this is the allograft, which is passed. You can also do this arthroscopically, which is passed. And this allograft goes and gets fixed over the glenoid and the GT on the superior aspect of the head. And then you fix it, tighten it, and suture it back again. So if you see here, suture it back again to the remaining cuff tissue. So this prevents the superior migration of the head and delays the rotator cuff arthropathy. There are certain tendon transfer procedures like latissimus dorsi transfer. If you have a Gutelier classification of 4 or 5, you know that you're not going to repair, or if you repair, it is not going to work. Then you can do procedures like latissimus dorsi transfer. Basically, you take the latissimus dorsi from its insertion point on the anterior side of the humerus, convert it from an internal rotator to an external rotator by putting it onto the side of the insertion of the rotator cuff. Okay, so there are a lot of indications and contraindications, but you have to assess. So if you have a irreparable cuff tear, then you go for a LD transfer. And finally, if there's a cuff arthropathy, then there was no solution for it for so many years, because if your rotator cuff are not working, then what are you going to do? But now, since the advent of the reverse shoulder arthroplasty, we do get really good outcomes with reverse shoulder arthroplasty for in cases of irreparable cuff damage with arthropathy. And the concept is basically, the deltoid takes over the function of all these muscles. So you, the center of the rotation of the humeral head is medialized by changing so you basically use the head on the glenoid and you make the humerus into a cup. Okay, so you actually change. If you see the left side, you can see this is the normal head. This is the total shoulder arthroplasty and this is the glenoid. Whereas now in the reverse shoulder, you have a head which is on the glenoid and the cup is on the humeral side. Okay, so this has given us really good outcomes in cases of cuff arthropathy. However, you have to understand that the life of this is very limited. It is 15 to 20 years at the max. And so you have to choose the patients very carefully before you go ahead with the reverse shoulder arthroplasty, because after a long period of time, there's deltoid fatigue and there's a lot of bone loss which happens, which is again difficult to treat in the long run. Okay, why does rehab protocol differ? This is a question which we see often, because the rehab protocol might differ based on surgeon to surgeon. It might differ based on patient to patient. And that is because all these patients we are treating have a lot of variation in their cuff quality, tear patterns, bone quality. When you operate, the operating surgeon is the best person to know what has happened for that particular patient, and then he can decide what is the protocol. Because if I have not done that particular surgery, I will not be able to comment about what has been done, what is the strength of the construct, and how fast we can mobilize the patient. And the success of the surgery depends on both intraoperative construct as well as the maintenance of cuff tissue in the footprint. You have to understand that it is not a surgery or what you achieve on table, but it is what you achieve after 3 to 6 months of the surgery. So that is why it's different. So I think I'll not cover this, because we can cover it in the second part. So this was my normal protocol. So what I take home message, basically there are a lot of messages. One is the evaluation. Evaluation is very important. You have to evaluate, reevaluate, think about it. Every patient is different. Every pathology is different. Unless you try to find out what is happening, what is wrong is happening, the treatment is not going to work. Do not treat unless you properly achieve the diagnosis. If you think the diagnosis is incomplete, or if you think you're going to miss something, then you give cross references, take proper opinions, do proper investigations before you start the rehab. Don't take the onus or the blame of patient on your head. If you're having physical problems, then therapy may not benefit it right away. You have to re-establish the anatomy before you start the therapy, And as we discussed before, just before the meet, the coordination between the surgeon and the therapist is very important to give the best outcome to the patient, whether it's a conservative or whether it's a, in a post-op patient. But the outcome really depends on how well you communicate and how good your team is, because none of us can work individually. We have to work with the team to give the best result to the patient. And patient education, discussion with the patient, giving them all the possibilities. Don't show them the moon. Tell them what is really wrong. They may change the surgeon, they may change the therapist, but you be very clear, be very honest what is going to happen. And that is what you are, what is going to give you a satisfied patient. So there'll be obstacles, there'll be doubters, there'll be mistakes, but we have to keep going, doing the hard work, and then there's a lot of success that you're going to make. Thank you very much.
Thank you, yeah. Dr. Nerulkar, for such a wonderful lecture. Dr. Nerulkar has really...
Shall I stop sharing?
Yeah, please.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So, Dr. Nerulkar has shown, actually discussed every minute details of the arthroscopic surgery, and before that, how the evaluation is important, how even minute details like anatomy of acromion and how it affects the decision making, how to do the various tests for rotator cuff muscles. Then he has also given us very detailed idea of various options of the surgery, including intra-articular injections or Muga therapy. And then he has covered all the recent advances which are there in the surgery, like open surgery versus arthroscopic surgery. And in the arthroscopic surgery, the detailed advances, like right from single row surgery to double row surgery to hybrid fixation, even suture bridge and speed bridge, how to do it for biceps, which is a very important muscle, and if the irreparable rotator cuff situations arises, then how to do the bicep bridge or TFL graft or allograft. So thank you, Dr. Nerulkar, for your detailed lecture regarding the surgeries of arthroscopy. Now over to Ajita Madam for question and answer sessions. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We have two questions from the participants.
Yeah.
First is, like in your presentation, you said there are some of the rotator cuff tests can be asymptomatic. So
yeah,
what is the possible reason for the tear to be asymptomatic?
Okay, so what happens is in a degenerative situation, especially what happens is the tear progresses over a period of time, from a small tear, which can be infocal tear, or it can be a pasta like lesion. Pasta is partial avulsion of the supraspinatus tendon, and this particular cuff is not very rich in the nerve fibers. Okay, so these patients, unfortunately in India, patients will not come to you unless they have pain. And these patients may not experience pain unless the secondary problems start setting up. Okay. Unless the supraspinatus is not able to function, and now the deltoid is taking over and there's a pain over the deltoid region, or if the joint is going into arthritis, or if the joint is going into AC joint. So these particular, most of the time the rotator cuff patients will not have pain because it is not very pain sensitive muscle.
Okay. Second. Thank you.
So it's like ACL, even in the ACL,
okay,
the patient never gets pain. Yeah.
That's true. There's one question regarding the Muga.
Yeah.
How does it help to repair an injury? Doesn't it seem to be more harmful when you're doing Muga?
Absolutely correct. Absolutely correct. And that is why I had mentioned that it is a very controversial thing. 10-15 years back, we used to do a lot of manipulations. Recently, I have done only one manipulation in last 5 years. And that was for very specific indication when the patient had, that is not for rotator cuff basically, had repaired a dislocation. So it was a Bankart's, and patient did not do any rehab, and patient came with a stiff shoulder. So I had done a manipulation. For rotator cuffs, I have not done any manipulation in the last 5 years. A lot of people are still doing it, but it is a very controversial topic. You can create a lot of problems with manipulation and it's better to do arthroscopic release.
Okay. For extra articular injection therapy that you said, what exactly, what is the approach that has been widely used in of tendinitis and how it is advantageous?
For the extra articular, basically it is done especially for the supraspinatus tendinosus.
Tendinosus.
For tendinopathy. So you can give a free hand injection or you can go. So I would personally recommend if you can give an ultrasound guided injection, it is really good because you can actually pinpoint, you can see the supraspinatus tendon, you can see the needle, you can, under the ultrasound, you exactly go where the pathology is and give the injection. However, if you get the right plane, if you know the anatomy properly, then you can go from the posterior lateral corner from where we make the portal for the rotator cuff repair. You go under the acromion, you look for how much resistance you get. So if you are into the subacromial recess or the subacromial space where the bursa is there, and when you try to push the injection, it actually goes quite freely. If you are into a tissue, if you are into a cuff tendon, if you are into bone, obviously it will not be pushed.
Yeah.
So that is the lack of resistance, and maybe it is a practice that gives you. It's really difficult to find out injection positions for shoulder.
How long?
And wherever possible.
How long lasting?
Long lasting. It's I have seen broad. There's no single time frame I can give. Because some patients have never come back with pain. They say that you have given me injection. It's been 2 years now. I have this friend of mine. He is having the same problem. Some patients do not benefit at all. You have to convey to the patient right up front that this may not benefit you at all.
Yeah.
You have to tell the patient the worst.
That's
the patient is on the injection is only given so that there is a temporary pain elevation, and you can undergo with the rehab portion of it. Okay. Also, if you have a tendinosis and if you give an injection, if you get a transient pain relief, you also know that you are actually treating with tendinosis itself and not treating with any other pathology. So there are multiple ways to it, but no guarantees at all. You can't guarantee. You can't give the time. It's very bad to comment because then patient will come and haunt you. Yaar, aapne toh 6 mahina bola tha, ye toh 2 hi mahina ho. So it is unpredictable completely.
We had heard about some biologic options that are used, like certain growth factors or cytokines. There was something like mesenchymal stem cells.
Yes.
Also, platelet-rich plasma was gaining popularity. There was a paper review, I think 2018, that I had read once. So, what's its role, either in conservative therapy or post-operative to augment the healing process?
See, in post-operative therapy, definitely I would not give it. Because when you are doing the surgery, and if you realize that there is a biological problem there, at that particular point of time, you do the microfractures. Okay? And then you stimulate healing. Okay? These microfractures itself, they are done even in ACL meniscal injuries, they are done in shoulder. These microfractures itself give those PRP or stem cells or whatever that we are going to inject. Okay. So there is no additional role of giving any injections. Okay. However, in conservative patients, you can actually do this. You can give this if the patient is not improving. But again, I have not come across any level one study. There is a proper randomized study between non-injection and injection techniques or difference between the injections which is there. Options that are there are, except your steroid, there are PRP injections that are given. There are stem cell injections that are given. And even I have seen a few patients who have been, I have not given, but they have come to me with hyaluronate injections being into the subacromial or the joint. But there are no clinical level one studies to give you or conclusively state that this has to be given and this is going to function in this particular way.
Yes, sir. as you mentioned in old chronic recurrent tears, the management is difficult. And regarding those cable type surgeries, to your experience, what is the post-operative prognosis?
Post-operative prognosis. So, if you have a good muscle tendon junction, muscle tendon unit, which you can get back to its original position, and then you can go give a good fixation, the prognosis is going to be excellent. The thing is, if you are not able to take through, that is a decision which is preoperative plus intraoperative. So you anticipate that there can be a problem in this particular surgery, and you keep all the other options ready. If you are not able to get those cables back, if you are not able to get the cuff, so you have to understand that it is not about what you get in the surgery. You have to figure out whether this particular surgery is going to work for next 6 months. So if there is a cuff that you are stretching, pulling and getting it back and pushing it onto that GT, this may not last. Then at the back of the mind, it is always you are worried as to what is going to happen, and then you mobilize the patient very slow. So in case you are not able to get it back, then your second, third, fourth options have to be ready. It has to be already explained to the patient beforehand that if we are not able to repair the cuff to a satisfactory measure, then whatever the problem is which you observe during the surgery, you can take the you can go to the second or third plan. So that has to be decided preoperatively and intraoperatively. But the prognosis is good unless, so the whole thing about prognosis is whether you're going to get the tendon back to the position and whether you are able to fix it without any undue tension. If you can do that, there's no problem.
When we are rehabilitating a patient, what are the points that we need to keep in mind for partial and for full thickness tears?
So this is a post.
And how soon? Or? How soon should the exercises begin after surgery?
Okay, so exercises will begin immediately. Considering that if I know I have done the job well, the range of movement is going to begin immediately, the passive range. So I begin with the rotations with the 30 degrees of flexion, 30 degree forward flexion, 30 degree of abduction. Bracing is continued for 1.5 months. Bracing and icing is initial, but the movement so you have to begin immediately because these patients go into stiffness very fast, and if you don't mobilize the patient, it is very difficult to get them back on track after 6 weeks to 8 weeks. Okay. And the mobilization gradually increases as per the patient comfort.
Yes, true. What is the absolute contraindication for physiotherapy in this? In what condition do you the exercises are contraindicated? Is there any such?
No. I don't think so.
Okay. And so the reverse.
I didn't get the question.
Is there any condition post-operative?
Yeah.
Or even conservatively, when you're managing the patient.
Yeah.
Is there any contraindication to physiotherapy?
No. There is no contraindication. There's no contraindication to physiotherapy, but we have to assess the physiotherapy. Suppose if I get a patient and if I send it to my friend therapist, then there's a certain amount of improvement that I expect. So yes, if I'm not able to get at least 20 to 25 to 30% improvement in say 2 weeks, then I think somewhere down the line we are going wrong, or we are concentrating on some. We are basically. Miss something, okay, and then you have to review. But there is no contraindication as such.
And in reverse glenoid surgery, how soon do you expect results? The range of motion?
Yeah, the range of motion. Again, I mobilize every patient immediately. You know, because range of motion is again, it's a gradual thing. It's not a, actually I had my protocol, but I skipped it because of the time.
The question arises because in Tata Memorial Hospital, we also have patients with the surgeons performing glenoid, reverse glenoid. But the protocol is something different because it's a tumor and a lot of resection has been done, but the deltoid is preserved. That's the reason to go in for reverse glenoid.
Okay. Yeah, this is for the tumor
specific. But the protocol is different.
Okay.
In that case, rotator cuff, how soon can you initiate the ROM?
I do it immediately.
Okay.
Yeah, immediately.
Because we delay.
There is no reason. There is no reason for delay of mobilization in basically tumor surgeries. I think there are a lot of other things involved. You resect a lot of soft tissue in tumors. And so the dynamics would be different because I have not done a reverse shoulder for a tumor surgery. So the dynamics is different because the pathology is different and the resection amount. Here in rotator cuff pathology, we are not resecting anything. The only thing is that the cuff muscles are probably atrophied and they are not functional. And that particular function is to be taken over by deltoid. So I think that the protocol will change depending on the cause or the etiology. But in cuff pathology, there is no reason to delay.
Okay. So just one last question that we take right now. Does hyperlipidemia affect the healing post-operative?
Hyperlipidemia?
Yes.
I don't think so. This hyperlipidemia is now one big controversy even for the physicians. Because there have been recent literatures from US coming. I'm not a physician, but I have come across certain recent papers which say that it doesn't make a difference in general. So I'm not very sure about it. But in rotator cuff, definitely not. Definitely not.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
We'll go to the next session. To the chairperson, Dr. Josna, please.
Thank you, Dr. Ajita. Now, our second speaker is Dr. Ajit Dabholkar, who is the professor and head in the sports physiotherapy in the School of Physiotherapy, D.Y. Patil University, Nehru, Navi Mumbai. He is a graduate from St. G.S. Medical College and postgraduate in musculoskeletal physiotherapy from PNMC, Mumbai. He has completed his PhD from D.Y. Patil University. He has more than 16 years of academic experience. He has 40 publications in peer-reviewed journal and book chapters in Springer. He is certified Mulligan's practitioner, NDS certified, kinesiotaping certified, trained in kinetic control and certified yoga practitioner. Sports physiotherapy. He is a sports physiotherapist for IPL, ISL, FIFA Under 17 World Cup, World Drive Safety Series recently. So now I invite Dr. Ajit Dabholkar for his presentation. Over to Ajit.
Hello, Ajit, are you there? Hello?
Ravindra is muted, Vidya is also muted. The floor is also muted. Do screen sharing for him.
Ajit, can you hear me? Hello, can you hear me, ma'am?
Yeah, I can hear you.
But is Ajit's screen is not coming. I'm not able to see the screen.
So,
shall I share?
open? Yeah, yeah.
Okay, I'll do that.
But Ajit's audio, just check his audio.
Let me check. 1 minute. Huh?
Because his audio appears muted, audio and video. Both appear muted. I'm giving him a call.
One second. Ajit, are you able to hear me now?
Yes. Now I can hear you.
Yeah, please. Switch on. Are you sharing your screen? Please share your screen. Let's see.
Put his video on. Tell him to put his video on.
Even you put on your video.
It is showing me join the meeting. I don't know why.
So please join it.
You are there in the meeting. Yeah.
You are there in the meeting. You join it. 1 second. I'll just do something. Otherwise, I'll just put on this thing.
You have, stopped my video. Can you just do that?
Yeah. One second.
Video on karo. Video on karo.
Post has stopped the video. It has come.
Okay. Yes.
Yeah. Start my video now.
Yes, please start it. Let's see.
Yeah. It's on now. Yeah.
Your screen sharing, please. No, this is my screen, I suppose.
Stops sharing your screen, so his screen.
Can you share the screen?
You're not able to share, Ajit?
No, I'm not able to share.
Let me check, wait.
Yeah. Abhishek, sir, stop sharing your screen. Sarah, stop sharing. Abhishek, sir, stop sharing.
Yeah, I have stopped sharing.
Okay, this is my screen. I have stopped sharing. Ajit, now try from your side. No.
The participant screen sharing is on.
Yeah, it is on. I have just checked it.
You may have to give him permission to join, which is there at the tab near a share screen. The host has...
It is given, sir. Yeah, we have given. Yeah. All participants can share. Who can share? I've just now checked.
Okay.
1 second, Ajit. I'm sharing, huh?
Yeah. Please.
Fine?
Yeah, fine.
Yeah. Sorry for the technical glitch.
Okay. Can I start now?
Yes, please. Go ahead.
Okay. Thank you, MBIP, Arthroscopy Academy, for inviting me for this talk on physiotherapy in rotator cuff involvement. I'm going to speak on evidence-based management. My objectives for this talk is to understand the risks and mechanisms of the rotator cuff pathology, to understand the biomechanical factors in causation of rotator cuff pathology, rationale of exercise in rotator cuff pathology. So as this image tells you that the rotator cuff problems are age old and it is existing since centuries back. And therefore 1 in 4 is suffering from shoulder pain. So it's quite a prevalent problem. And as you see this image, that the anatomical studies of the shoulder by Leonardo da Vinci talks about the importance of the shoulder muscles and the importance of the rotator cuff muscles back then from the Renaissance period. Now I'm going to talk about some shades of gray, which are certain controversial topics and which are going to highlight it, and what I'm going to put spotlight into what are these shades of gray in my talk. Now, disorders of the rotator cuff are the most common problems. And the prevalence is of this is from the partial thickness to full thickness. And as your age advances, the problem of the rotator cuff disease increases, and it starts at as early as 40 years. This particular graph tells you that as you age, there is increased incidence of rotator cuff tears, and you find that as you go higher into the age group, aging, there is more of rotator cuff tears seen.
Now, the slideshow.
Now, one second, Ajit. Just hint me if I'm in the right slide.
Then go ahead. Go ahead.
Yeah, yeah, please.
One ahead.
This one?
Then next to him. And go on slideshow.
Okay. This one? This one is the right one?
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
Now?
It's not go moving. Ahead. It's not moving.
The screen is not moving.
It's moving for me.
I'm on the seventh slide. Prevalence of rotator cuff tears.
Hello, Ravindran sir, this, but it is towards just the first slide.
Yeah, it's not going ahead.
Yeah.
Can you please go ahead with that slide?
Can you now, shut it and
start? Have I minimized the slide now?
Yes, yes. So, I'll start
you want to set you.
Yeah.
This is the slide you wanted, right?
Yes,
now?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes,
I'll go from here. Is it visible
can
now?
Can you repeat, sir?
Yes, yes, it's visible.
Go on slideshow, Ravindra.
It is in slideshow, ma'am.
Okay, no, I'll just tell you. I'll just tell you what we are next slide. Then you do the next slide according to.
Yeah. Ma'am.
Okay. So, in this picture, the dominant limb, rotator cuff tears, it has been found that the dominant limb, though asymptomatic, which we undergo an ultrasound examination, it has also been found to have a rotator cuff tear. So dominant limb also is one of the risk factor. Though you may have an asymptomatic shoulder, you may still have a rotator cuff tear. Next slide. Next slide. Next slide. The rotator cuff disease contributes to pain and disability and has an impact on health-related quality of life. The outcomes of the patients with rotator cuff tendinopathy treated with surgery are comparable with conservative treatments that includes exercise or combined exercises with a multimodal rehab program. So it's very important to understand that the exercise therapy is the backbone of any tendon rotator cuff tendinopathy, and it's primarily the evidence-based component which needs to be thought of. I think the slide which is there is not coinciding with what I'm saying. The slide shared. Hello.
Slide not moving.
I think it's moving in my screen, but it is not moving in. Again, share it for you. Is it right?
Yeah, right.
But just 1 second before starting.
Yeah.
Is it moving to the next?
Yes. Now it is moving.
Again, it's moving to the next?
Yes.
But I don't know. I'm just doing the same. Okay.
So,
this is what?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, the next slide. The next slide now.
Okay. Now allow me.
Yeah, allow me.
Yes. Okay. Sorry, yeah.
So, however, it is very important that some patients still have continued persistent pain and disability. And why this high prevalence of continued pain is because we need to understand the mechanisms underlying shoulder impingement. And therefore, if we know the underlying mechanisms, we can effectively guide the treatment and have a better prognosis and outcomes. Next slide.
Visible?
Yeah.
Yes.
So I'll tell you next slide, then you go to the next slide.
Yes.
So rotator cuff disease has been classically described as a progressive disorder of the rotator tendons, which begins with acute tendinitis, progresses to tendinosis with degeneration, and has partial thickness tears or goes ahead with a full thickness tears. Next slide.
Visible?
Yes. Diagnostic terms of rotator cuff tendinitis tendinosis represent tendon pathology. It's primarily a tendon pathology, and rotator cuff tendinitis is often used to define acute or chronic problems associated with, and by definition, inflammation. However, there may be no inflammation in the cells of rotator cuff tendons and subacromial bursa. So it's very, very important to understand that sometimes there may not be an inflammatory cells. So it may not be having inflammation at all. Next slide. So this slide is taken from the book Rotator Cuff Tear, which talks about the multifactorial etiology of the cuff tear, which talks about the smoking habit. The higher the incidence of smoking, the higher there are chances of your massive rotator cuff tears hypertension, hypercholesterolemia, diabetes, alcohol habit, manual worker, which is overuse injuries. All these are component which is related to, problems and, prevalence of rotator cuff tears. And these components are very, very important, which talks about the prognosis of any rehabilitation, whether it is surgically managed or conservatively managed. Next slide. One of the component also is there may be a degenerated acromioclavicular joint, and that can have a role to play in rotator cuff tears. Next slide. Hyperkyphosis. Hyperkyphosis more than 50 degrees, measured on Cobb's method, have been found to decrease the the subacromial space, the anterior humeral distance, and therefore that is also one of the risk factors for massive rotator cuff tears. Next. Now, what are the mechanisms of rotator cuff tendinopathy? We need to understand the intrinsic, extrinsic, and the combination of mechanisms which are going to cause tendinopathies. Extrinsic factors are defined as those causing compression or shear of the rotator cuff tendons, and the intrinsic problems are related to the degenerative of the tendon. Next slide. So the Neils proposed an extrinsic mechanism to the etiology of the rotator cuff tendinopathy with compression of the tendons and associated tissues within the subacromial space under the anterior aspect of the acromion or surrounding structures, which he coined as subacromial impingement syndrome. So when we talk about shoulder impingement syndrome, we are talking about the extrinsic mechanism which causes primarily compression to the rotator cuff tendons. Next slide. So the diagnosis of subacromial impingement inherently implies, which is an extrinsic compression, which causes narrowing of the subacromial space, which may not accurately represent all rotator cuff tendon pathologies. So, and there is also one of the mechanisms, which is extrinsic mechanism, which causes internal impingement in subjects with overhead athletes, which is given by a wonderful paper by Becord et al. About overhead athletes. Next slide. So this internal impingement occurs primarily on the compression of the articular side rather than on the bursal side of the rotator cuff tendons between the posterior superior glenoid rim and humerus when the arm is in full abduction, external rotation and extension. Next slide. So here I want to tell you, next slide please. So this is very important slide for us when we talk about these mechanism. Extrinsic mechanism is primarily the subacromial impingement syndrome, and there may be posterior superior internal impingement in athletes, and there can be primary impingement problems associated, which can be post-traumatic deformity, subacromial spurs, acromion morphology problems, acromioclavicular problems. And here I'm going to talk more on the secondary problem, secondary impingement, which are biomechanical and functional problems, which lead to scapular kinematics problem stability and humeral kinematic stability, and the various components with respect to soft tissue problems, scapular muscle performance, thoracic mobility, glenohumeral capsule issues, and rotator cuff problems. So I'm going to talk more on the secondary impingement and the biomechanical issues are related to that. An intrinsic mechanism is from primarily all related to tendon problems, the tendon vascularity, tendon biology, tendon mechanical properties, tendon morphology, and genetic predisposition. Next slide. So extrinsic mechanism, as I told you, is primarily related to bursal side. It is causing compression, and compression leading to narrowing of the subacromial space, which include anatomical factors, biomechanical factors, and combination of both. My talk will be primarily about this. And the acromial humeral distance is normally between 7 and 14 mm in healthy shoulders, but it is reduced in those with rotator cuff tendon tears. Next slide. So it is very, very important to evaluate. Next slide, please. It's very, very important to evaluate the subacromial space in dynamic movements because you are going to find those, you know, functionally narrow when it is the subacromial space is functionally narrow, primarily, you know, at a 90 degree flexion or an abduction issues. So it's very, very important to not statically evaluate the subacromial space, but dynamically. Next. Now, what are the anatomical factors? Anatomical factors are variations in the shape of the acromion, which Sir has already spoke about, orientation of the slope or the angle of the acromion, osseous changes in the acromial clavicular joint or in the coracoacromial ligament. Next slide. And the types of acromion, which are primarily the flat, the type 2, which is the curved, and the hooked. The classification of Bigliani et al. Have found that the type 2 and the type 3 have not good prognosis, and therefore they need to be reshaped. Next slide. So what are the intrinsic mechanisms? As I told you, is primarily of the problem of the tendon itself, which leads to tendon degradation because of the process of aging, poor vascularity because supraspinatus has the gray zone. It can also have altered biology, which is apoptosis or cell death, change in collagen type vary, and there can be genetic component to it. Next slide. So the literature suggests that if it's an intrinsic mechanism, which is primarily related to the cuff pathology, then there can be debridement done of the rotator cuff tendon without acromioplasty. And if it's an extrinsic mechanism, there can be decompression done in the form of acromioplasty, which is a surgical procedure. Next slide. So here I want to talk about primarily the biomechanical factors which has led to extrinsic mechanism and rotator cuff tendon compression, which includes abnormal scapular and humeral kinetics, postural abnormalities, rotator cuff and scapular muscle performance deficits, and decreased extensibility of the pectoralis minor or posterior soft tissue tightness. The scapular and the humeral kinetic abnormalities leads to dynamic narrowing of the subacromial space, leads to tendon compression, leads to superior translation of the humeral head, and it can also cause aberrant scapular motion that causes the acromion to move inferiorly. Next slide. So it's very, very important to know your biomechanics first. So if only deltoid is acting, then the head of the humerus is primarily going into superiorly. So the superior translation will be much more compared to the rotational component. Okay. Whereas this action of the superior migration of the humerus in dynamic stabilization of the shoulder is offset by the rotator cuff. Which offsets the superior migration of the deltoid and therefore maintains the compression of the humeral head onto the glenoid and give dynamic stability to the humerus. And therefore, superior migration is a component very common when the rotator cuff problem is affected or it is weak. Next slide. So here is an example of an experiment which they showed. They did a fatigue experiment to the rotator cuff, and they found that even fatigue of the rotator cuff led to a superior migration of the humeral head. So even a fatigue protocol has led to a superior migration of the humeral head. So humeral head migration can affect the subacromial space, and this subacromial space can be a problem leading to, affection of the tendons within that. Next slide. So this is one of the important factors which we all physiotherapists should know, that there is a role of chronicity. As the chronification of the rotator cuff tendinopathy is important, it leads to central motor alterations. These central motor alterations have found to be decreased corticoexcitability of the infraspinatus muscle. So it's very, very important that there has been, motor control problem issues with respect to infraspinatus and therefore there has been importance of motor control programs which are coming into rotator cuff rehabilitation. Next slide. there is a role of central sensitization. It is one of the gray zones, as I told you, that we don't know why some patients, in spite of a good conservative treatment or surgical treatment, are not good copers, and we need to find that the pain still not have reduced. So these patients may be having central sensitization, which causes neuroplastic changes in the peripheral nervous system and the central nervous system. And therefore, we need to identify these patients of patients of central sensitization. And therefore, the central sensitization inventory more than 40 can tell us that these patients definitely have central sensitization. And therefore, the role of importance of pain neurophysiology and the importance of explained pain and importance of pain neuroscience education in these patients. Next slide. So this is very, very important that when you talk about shoulder, it's very, very important that we know the force couples, because the force couples like the rotator, the serratus anterior and the lower trapezius are prone for inhibition, which is a classical paper of Kibler et al. And when the inhibition of the serratus anterior and the lower trapezius is there, the upward rotation of the scapula gets affected. Next slide. So this next slide please. The alteration of the scapula, which is called as scapular dyskinesis, is seen in many patients, like 67 to 100% patients. And primarily is because of the inhibition of the lower stabilizers of the scapula, primarily the serratus anterior and the lower trap, at the same time rhomboid and middle trap. So it's very, very important that these muscles are initially inhibited because of shoulder pain. Next slide. And therefore, next slide, please. So that's why the scapular rehabilitation is a key component of shoulder rehabilitation and should be instituted early in shoulder rehabilitation, which leads to frequently violent shoulder injuries healing. We know about the scapular motion, the upward and the downward rotation of the scapula, that this is a three dynamic movements of the scapula, the upward and the downward rotation of the scapula, the internal and the external rotation of the scapula, and the anterior tilt and the posterior tilt of the scapula. So upward rotation, downward rotation, internal rotation, external rotation, anterior tilt and the posterior tilt are the prime motions of the scapula. Next slide, please. So it's very, very important what happens in shoulder impingement and cuff tears is scapular asymmetry, decreased upward rotation, decreased posterior tilt, and increased internal rotation. This is a problem which is a crux problem in patients with shoulder impingement and cuff tears. Next slide. So what are the proposed biomechanical mechanisms of scapular kinematic deviations? Inadequate serratus anterior firing, excess upper trapezius activation, increase in the pectoralis minor tightness, posterior soft tissue may be tight, and there may be thoracic kyphosis or flexed posture associated with it. So it's very, very important. We need to identify this, evaluate this, do a multi-system impairment analysis and establish these facts, whether these patients are having. And then only the appropriate strategies can be devised. Next. So here I am telling you about the scapula and the problems of the dysfunction of the scapula. Scapula is something which you have to understand, which I have devised an acronym, IAM scapula, where I is inferior border prominent, M is medial border prominent, and superior border prominent. So type 1, type 2, and type 3 scapular dyskinesias can be seen in patients with scapular dysfunction. Next slide. So it's very, very important that you evaluate the scapular dyskinesis. According to the Scapular Summit 2013, we can do the scapular assistance test and the scapular repositioning test, which are primarily symptom relieving tests in impingement. So when the symptoms are relieved and sometimes even the strengths are better, it is understood that these patients are the patients needing scapular rehabilitation strategies. You can also do a scapular dyskinesis test by weighted cuffs of 3 pounds and 5 pounds in flexion and abduction and find out whether there is any scapular dyskinesia observed. Next slide. So what are the scientifically supported scapular intervention? You need to work on serratus anterior strengthening or retraining, upper trapezius activation reduction, because you want to gear down the upper trapezius, because if upper trapezius is activating too much, there will be more of, you know, superior movement of the clavicle, and that also decreases the subacromial space. Posterior shoulder stretching, pectoralis minor stretching, and thoracic extension postures and exercise needs to be given to these patients. It has also been found that thoracic extension exercises have been found to be better in rotator cuff tendinopathies. Next slide. So what is an exercise prescription? It is very, very important. Previous slide, please. Previous slide. The exercise prescription primarily is talking about effectiveness of specific program. You need to evaluate which program is more effective, which is scientifically having a rationale. What are the patient's expectations and demands? What are the tissues' irritability? You need to identify these first. And what are the muscle activity levels and recruitment patterns we need to work on? Because there has to be a rationale when you give an exercise prescription. So when we see primarily patients of shoulder impingement, there is lower trapezius and middle trapezius less firing. Serratus anterior recruitment is less, whereas pectoralis minor tightness is more, levator scapular tightness is more, upper trapezius, there may be more activation or hyperactive or least less active. Even the rhomboids may be more active or less active. So this needs to be a primary a problem. Now what? Next slide.
So,
this is very, very important to understand how to activate supraspinatus. So, full can, prone can, infraspinatus sideline, external rotation, prone external rotation at 90 degree abduction, external rotation with the towel roll, subscapularis at 90 degree, at 0 degree abduction, internal rotation, at 90 degree abduction, internal rotation, or diagonal internal rotation. So these are the primarily muscle work which has been shown with EMG picture, that this is how these muscles needs to be recommended for exercises. Next slide. Also the serratus anterior, next slide please. The serratus anterior with a push-up plus dynamic hug, serratus anterior punch when 20 degrees, the activation of the lower trap by prone full can, prone external rotation at 90 degree, prone horizontal abduction at 90 degree with external rotation or bilateral external rotation. Middle trapezius can be by prone row or prone horizontal abduction at 90 degree with external rotation. So these are the EMG based exercise which we need to work on patients with these problems. Next slide please. So it's very, very important that you need to first learn to activate the supraspinatus by using self-palpation and Melton imagery. Add on to a cuff or a small pillow here and work later on self-palpation. Tactile cues and mental imagery for self-palpation. You need to understand how the muscle is working. Work on that isometric lateral rotation. And therefore, you need to have a conscious activation, conscious control of the muscles of the scapula, which is very, very important in activating and recruiting the muscles of the scapula. Next slide. So this is talking about how the tactile cues this person is being given and working on different modes, like this person is using the TheraBands and working in different ranges. Of course, these can be in the advanced stages of the shoulder cuff rehabilitation. Next slide. This is an example of how this sleeper stretch can be given to the posterior soft tissue if it's tight, because posterior soft tissues are primarily tight in overhead athletes, and we need to stretch that, because if posterior soft tissue is tight, that can lead to anterior tilt of the scapula. Anterior tilt of the scapula is not a good position, which leads to again compromising of the subacromial space. Next slide, please. Pectoralis minor tightness. Pectoralis minor tightness will lead to more of anterior tilting of the scapula, more of internal rotation of the scapula, and it is very, very important to measure the pectoralis minor length from the coracoid process to the fourth rib adjacent to the sternum. You can also measure the round, you know, the rounded shoulders from the plinth to the acromion. And if it's more than 6.5 centimeters, then it is bound to that this particular muscle is tight. This the scapular retraction at 30 degrees flexion has been found to, you know, be a specific exercise for stretching of pectoralis minor. You need to work on tightness of the pectoralis minor and work on even at the 180 degrees for stretching of the pectoralis minor. So it's very, very important to stretch the pectoralis minor because that can lead to alteration of the scapula. Next slide, please. As I told you that scapular thoracic issues can lead to decrease in the subacromial space, and it has been also been found to be the thoracic mobilization, mid thoracic and cervical thoracic mobilization has been found to be better in rotator cuff tendinopathies, and therefore the postures of thoracic postures can need to be corrected by giving thoracic extension type of exercises. Next slide. It's very, very important that you walk primarily at 0 degrees, because 0 degrees of internal rotation and external rotations are primarily working and recruiting the subscapularis and the infraspinatus muscle. So from 0 degrees, if you go to towards your trunk, that's subscapularis, and if you go from your trunk to the neutral position, that's infraspinatus muscle. And these are the simple exercises you can start initially with in recruiting the shoulder, in the scapularis, subscapularis and infraspinatus. It's very, very important to work on the supraspinatus, and it's how to rehabilitate the supraspinatus. There has been controversies with respect to which position is better, whether the empty can position is better or the full can position is better. Well, the empty can position decreases, it's more of an injuring movement, and it also leads to humeral going into anterior movement. And therefore, that leads to more of an injury movement. And that's why full can position with external rotation is an important thing to remind you about activation of the supraspinatus muscle. So here again, I'm going to the higher exercises of activating the muscle using external rotation. He's using the therabar over here, whereas this cuff added over here can improve the activation of the posterior cuff more. And you're going into the higher ranges by still working in the scaptional plane at 90-90 position. Next slide. These are the exercises, Blackburn exercises, which again talks about, you know, balancing the trapezi and working on the middle trapezius and the lower trapezius and activating patterns and recruiting the right recruitment of the middle trapezius and the lower trapezius, balancing the trapezi and the upper trapezius. So Blackburn exercises has its place in management of recruiting the trapezi. Next slide. This is an higher exercises where prone 90-90 plyometric exercises for posterior rotator cuff and scapular training can be given. This is a very specific exercise for overhead athletes and which can be a higher end exercises for recruiting the posterior cuff. Next slide. This is more of a subscapularis activation. This activation is primarily at forward flexion. Forward flexion with internal rotation, because we can start from here and go to the abduction, external rotation and forward flexion to internal rotation. So you start with this and then go to this abduction, external rotation and full internal rotation. Next slide. Serratus anterior activation is extremely important. These are the exercises which shows about dynamic hugging action over here on the left side, whereas recruiting of the serratus anterior and the serratus anterior punch on the right side. So these are the muscles which we need to work on right activation of the serratus anterior. Don't forget even the push-up plus, which is primarily more of protraction and elbow extension preceding. So that is also one of the important activating patterns for serratus anterior. Next slide, please. So yes, trapezius activation primarily working on the W, the T, the Y. All these exercises will activate the trapezi and primarily working on the middle and the lower trapezius and balancing the trapezi actions. Next slide. This is a classic exercises of hand pulls, which she has talked about in her article, in a paper. We have of scapular muscles, which balances all the exercises. So she is using the forward flexion, the abduction with external rotation in prone, bone extension, and inside line, lateral rotation. So using even this cuff or a small pillow can add to the activation of the middle and the lower trapezius. Next slide, please. So again, you can go to the higher levels, as I told you, for activating the middle trapezius and the lower trapezius. Next slide. This is on unstable surface. Similar exercises can be done on unstable surface. These are high-end exercises which you can use in sports players and throwers primarily. Next slide. So here is a classic example of a scapular rehab algorithm which talks about lack of soft tissue flexibility. You should know which are the muscles which have lack of flexibility. Primarily the pectoralis minor, the levator scapula, the posterior soft tissue. And the if you know if these on evaluation, if they have found tight, the simple stretching program can be given, home program can be given. And if there is lack of muscle performance, you work on muscle control and muscle strength. You work on core contraction, activation of the force couples, neuromuscular coordination, conscious muscle control, advanced control during basic activities, and advanced control during sports activities. So you work on muscle control. At the same time, you work on muscle strength. You work on the important muscles like serratus anterior, lower and middle trapezius. You work on its conscious scapular control of these muscles, balance the ratios of all the trapezii, upper, middle, and lower, and then work on endurance and strength. Next slide, please. So it's very, very important. What are the two key factors? Primarily tendon healing and satisfactory function outcome. When will you get this? It's because of the skilled surgical technique and a well-programmed rehab protocol. Next slide. So what is the take-home message? Add external rotation component to exercise if you want to work on increasing the activity of middle trapezius and lower trapezius. Prefer elevation exercises over isolated protraction when you are recruiting the serratus anterior. Add external rotation or lying down position with head resting because you want to decrease the activity of the upper trapezius, which we saw in the Pools et al. Article description of scapular balance exercises. Work in open chain and not in closed chain, and add external rotation if you want to work on decreasing the activation of the pectoralis minor. And work overhead and closed chain if you want to decrease the activity of the levator scapula. Next slide. So it's very, very important that you need to work on the kinetic chain, because even the conscious contraction of the abdominal core activates the serratus anterior. Unstable surface activates the serratus anterior more. So you can use unstable surface because you can work on serratus anterior activity. And distal link, because scapula is also a link to your movements. So not making a fist, but keeping your hands open and working on the muscles, which is going to recruit the middle trap and the lower trap. So it's very, very important that you not make the fist while recruiting the middle trapezius and the lower trapezius. Next slide. Yes, as I showed over here, implementation of kinetic chain into scapular rehabilitation is very, very important. And we need to understand that it's not about the shoulder in athletes, it's about the whole kinetic chain rehabilitation. Next slide. Yes, understand the risk, which I just told you with respect to the evaluate the risk of patients, because these are the patients which are going to give you problems. These are the patients which may have problems of re-tears, within the 6 months. So you need to understand and educate the patients in totality about what you are going to expect in the next 6 months. Next slide. So it's very, very important that you don't treat any patient blindly. You need to evaluate the patient with what are the impairments. What are the impairments we need to evaluate with respect to impairment-based assessment. And if you do the impairment-based assessment, treatment strategies are very clear. So you don't, every patient may need a posterior capsule, stretching, but you need to evaluate whether that impairment exists in that patient. Okay. So it's very, very important to do an evaluation-based treatment strategy than just having a, protocol. Next slide. Thank you. Thank you so much. Hello.
Hello. Thank you, Ajit. Thank you for such a wonderful presentation.
Thank you so much.
You have really given us a very wide approach or eye opener. It was an eye opener. You have discussed about the intrinsic, extrinsic factors which are responsible for the rotator cuff and with the underlying mechanisms. You have also given us, make us aware about the multifactorial etiology of rotator cuff and how the posture also plays an important role when you are assessing the rotator cuff or impingement syndrome. You have also given us the importance of scapular and humeral kinetic change. You have discussed about scapular dyskinesia. You have shown us various tests of scapular dyskinesia, which are really, sometimes it becomes difficult to perform, but yes, you have covered them. And then most importantly, your exercise prescription part was beautiful. So you have given us the practical demonstrations for how to activate the muscle, how to stretch the overactive muscles, or how to relax or decrease the activities of overactive muscle with the evidence, which is presently used in the physical therapy. You have discussed about functional outcome measures and risk factors also. And you have given us the overall view of how to assess the patient and how to treat the patient. So thank you very much for this lecture.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Over to Ajita Madam for question answer sessions. Ajita Madam, please.
Thank you, sir, for this wonderful presentation.
Thank you, ma'am.
I haven't received many questions from the audience. I just had one question from when you are mobilizing, do you even give stretching of the capsule? Does that help for joint mobilization when you are mobilizing the joint for stiffness?
Which patients, ma'am?
Rotator cuff, when it becomes chronic.
Yes.
Chronic patient comes to you.
Yes.
In those cases, along with the scapular stability and the working on the shoulder girdle muscles, yes. Along with that, how do you mobilize the capsule also? Are you focusing on the capsule?
The posterior soft tissue tightness can be evaluated by in supine position, and you need to understand to do a cross adduction. Okay.
Posterior capsule.
And arrest the movement of the scapula. Okay. If you arrest the movement of the scapula, then you get a pure glenohumeral movement.
Yes. Okay.
So that is one of the important methods. At the same time, in athletes, there is also something called as glenohumeral internal rotation deficit. So if there is a glenohumeral internal rotation deficit, which is classically seen in overhead athletes, then again, this is a problem. So it is not just, posterior capsule tightness, but the associated components with that. There may be a subacromial crowding, there may be a posterior soft tissue tightness, there may be a scapular weakness. So as some author has told, explained it as a pathological soup, So you have to understand what problems are needed to be identified and what needs to be, worked upon depending upon the patient's, prime problems.
Thank you. And how soon do you go to full range? After a patient comes to you after assessment, you have identified a rotator cuff tear, partial tear. but it is chronic. So how soon do you try to mobilize the patient and go to full reach?
Initially, we have to go very slow because tendon healing is a problem. And tendon healing takes time. So initially, you can, the first thing you need to work on the range. And if the range is better, you go slow with respect to forward movements than adding abduction. Because a forward movement is much safer than doing abduction. So keeping into the, tendon healing, respecting tendon healing, respecting the pain,
yes,
respecting the problems of the patient, about what pathology he had, existing pathology and comorbid factors. You need to understand the tendon healing and go slow initially, because there are problems, because this partial tears can become full thickness tears if you're aggressive in the initial rehabilitation.
Yeah, that's true. Okay, there's one question from the participants. How would rehabilitation vary for internal and external impingement?
For internal and external?
External impingement.
External impingement. External impingement is primarily a problem with kids. Mainly the posterior superior component. The anterior impingement is internal impingement, and there is external impingement. So primarily you need to work on the, posterior cuff and the eccentric work of the rotator cuff tendons in a follow-through position. So follow-through position has more role to play in eccentric activity in overhead athletes. And you need to work on these components with respect to phases of throwing. You need to evaluate which phases of throwing is an important factor and need to really evaluate well. Primarily the follow through.
Okay. Thank you. That was a nice, interesting session, sir.
Thank you.
And I would hand over to the host, Dr. Ravindran. I don't see any more questions coming. Dr. Ravindran, for the vote of thanks. You're not audible. Dr. Ravindran, you're not
Yes, Sajita, I'm here. A couple of questions are there, but due to the paucity of time, we'll be passing on to you and we'll get back the answers. We'll get incorporated into the videos later on. So it's a privilege for me to present the vote of thanks at this particular lecture. So first of all, I would, on behalf of Mumbai branch of Indian Association of Physiotherapists, I apologize for the technical glitches. We are also learning technology now in this adversity. So kindly apologize all participants as well as the speakers. Apologize from our side and hope it will resolve it quite soon. And first and foremost, I would like to thank both the speakers and chairperson for readily agreeing to our request and participating in such wonderful, explicit and extensive lectures. I never knew when it became 2 hours time. It was really a fun on knowledge, resource of knowledge for all of us, and hoping to continue the same with you all, associate with you in many more sessions to come. So thank you all for coming and readily agreeing to participate in this webinar series. And not necessarily, I would again like to thank the Arthroscopy Academy Mumbai, who has been always associating with us in sports and physiotherapy and sports rehab aspect is concerned. So we would like to thank Dr. Roshan Wade and his team for his support in this year's webinar series. Also, I would like to thank Dr. Ajita for accepting the invite for moderating, and our team, technical team, Mayur and me, for putting up this live on YouTube. And of course, all the participants without which, whose support we will never be here. So thank you for supporting and coming in large numbers. And I think almost like more than 100 participants are here, both in YouTube as well as in Zoom. So I would like to thank all the participants for showing the confidence in us, which boosts our, us to do many more sessions like this. Thank you all, one and all, for joining. And we'll be coming back. The next session, I would like to share, the next session would be on... June 4th, which will be concluding our last session on the shoulder rehabilitation webinar series. It's about throwing injuries in athletes. So the first talk will be by Dr. Sandeep Biraris, who is an orthopedic surgeon and arthroscopic surgeon, will be dealing with the throwing injuries from his perspective. The second one will be by Dr. Niranjan Pandit, who is a physiotherapist, sports physiotherapist, and who will be dealing with assessment and management of throwing injuries. So I think this also is going to be an extensively informative webinar. So I request all of you to join, the details of which will be conveyed to you through our social media platforms and your emails. So once again, a big thank you from the team of executive members of Mumbai branch of Indian Association of Physiotherapists and Arthroscopic Academy, Mumbai. Thank you all for joining.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.